Shall I speak this side or this? Straight is here. Nobody is ahead of me. Can you all hear me? Well, welcome, friends, to this monthly meeting that we have every month in order to remain on track on our spiritual journey. Our spiritual journey is a journey into our own self to discover who we are. Looks funny that we should have to do something to find out who we are. We are who we are. We should know it. How come we don't know who we are and we have to do something to find out? Looks very odd. But the truth is, we have for a long, long time, maybe for thousands or millions of years, so long as we have been coming in different forms or human forms in this world, we have been continuously making a very big mistake. And the mistake is, we thought the jacket we were wearing was ourselves. Only difference was the jacket was the human body. We wear it for a little while. If we wore it continuously, I would say, it's good enough to say that is the self. It dies. It is not permanent. Everybody dies. The most enlightened people who gave such beautiful talks died. My own master, I call him great master. People call him great master. He was my greatest master, died. Everybody dies in their physical body. How can the physical body be ourself? We are wearing it very temporarily. Biggest mistake. But then if we discover any mistake, we have an opportunity to correct it. And this mistake we can correct today. We can correct this mistake by just simply examining who are we if we are not the physical body. Simple question. We have to put to ourselves, body is temporary, it will go, it will be buried or cremated or thrown away, it will go anyway. Each of the bodies sitting here will go anyway. So we put the question to ourselves, if I am not the body, who am I? The answer may come, you are nobody, body is the only thing. The answer can come, but it doesn't come like that. Because great researchers have done research that if the body were to die, do we die or not? Recent publications that I read say that there's scientific evidence that something stays alive and can get back into the body again. That there can be near-death experiences or what clinically is called clinical death, and then you can come back again. If the body is dead and gone, who comes back again? It's a very simple question. But the best answer would be, if you want to solve this problem, the best answer is, see how you feel if you don't have a body. We will all feel like that. When the physical death takes place, we will all stand there and wonder, who are we? We thought we were that body that died. We are seeing the body with our own eyes. The body was not us. Then who are we? Simple explanation can be found for this by doing something which we might call dying while living. Have the same identical experience you will have when you die. Now, if you have seen people dying, I had the opportunity to see a lot of people. Almost all my colleagues, my friends have gone. Some of them in terminal cases, in hospital for a long time, in hospice, nursing homes. I've gone and watched them dying. When they die, it appears that they leave this body in a particular order. They don't just suddenly die and we don't know what is happening. They die with their feet dying first, hands dying next, legs and arms dying next. How do we know? They are losing awareness. They are still talking. They are saying, will you put my leg on the right side? It's already on the right side. They don't feel it because the leg is already dead. So the death overtakes from the extremities of this body and moves to the bottom. And when they lose their awareness on the bottom, death is taking place. They think they are floating in the sky. They are not floating. The rest of the upper structure of the torso is intact and the bottom has disappeared because they can't feel it. They're dying. The death then moves upwards, killing them high. Heart stops. It looks like they're dying. Eyes are still twinkling and moving. You can see them trying to communicate. They can't speak. Ultimately, the death goes above the neck into the head, and brain dead, person is dead. Body is no good. Simple process. That means what death creates is the loss of awareness of the physical body gradually from the extremities to the head. What would happen if we were to try experimentally to do the same thing? Identical. What if we had a method of withdrawing our attention, withdrawing our awareness, withdrawing our life, as it were, from the extremities back the same way, in the same order, as actual death takes place? Several people have practiced different techniques to achieve this end. Can we achieve an end in which we can appear to be death exactly according to the signs and symptoms that the people who actually die get? It is possible to do so. And that practice is called withdrawing attention on that part of yourself which dies last, the head. Attention is a beautiful thing. It's a very big gift, because attention allows us to examine anything very closely. Beautiful flowers next to me, if I put attention on them, they look even more beautiful. I was in New Zealand last week, and there was a cup of water like this. I sometimes like to take a sip. There was a golden edging on this. I didn't notice it. Somebody told me that little cup without anything in it cost $150 because there is solid gold around it. Then I paid attention to it. When I paid attention, water tasted so much better. It was a cup that was holding the water. Attention is such a wonderful thing. It can enable you to appreciate, to be more aware of something. What if we were to put our attention in the head at that point which dies last? And we have the power to do it. We can put attention to the flower, they look more beautiful. Put attention to the cup, it looks more real. Look away and not put attention, it almost disappears. This world that we are living in is coming into being because we are aware of it. Awareness means that we have the ability to know something is existing. That's all. Not only know it's existing, but to be able to experience it in very close form, which is called perception, by the sense perceptions of the body. We perceive this whole world because we have sense of perception, and the perception is divided into sense perceptions. So we can say we can see, touch, taste, smell, all these things we can do because we have sense perceptions, and the whole world can be known to us. That's how we are knowing the world. Consider this. There is no other way that we have right now of knowing the world except this. Somebody can say, there's another way, I'd like to learn that. I've not found any way, nor have the scientists found it. Sense perceptions is the only reason why we know a world exists. Supposing you lose all your sense perceptions, the world disappears. A fact, a matter of fact. That is why it's something very important to know that sense perceptions are creating this, and sense perceptions are creating two kinds of awareness. One, an awareness immediately available to us through sense, five sense perceptions, and an awareness which is in our head, in our mind, about things existing outside this house, which you are not seeing, which you are not touching, not smelling. None of these sense perceptions are working, but you are still aware of something outside. That is mental awareness. This is physical awareness. Two kinds of awareness. What makes awareness possible? Consciousness. If we are not conscious, we cannot be aware. So basic thing is that the potential for awareness lies in consciousness, and we are conscious beings, therefore we are able to have awareness, mental awareness as well as physical awareness. Physical awareness we can explain with eyes we see, but then there is another kind of awareness in between the two, between the mental awareness, which is just knowing there's something outside. I remember I parked my car, I remember this thing, which is not immediate sensory perception. It's a mental awareness. Between the mental awareness and the physical awareness lies another kind of awareness. And that is imagination. We know the car is outside parked. We can imagine and see the car parked. When we see the car, not with these eyes. There's no car in front of us. Nor is it a mental thing that the car is outside. We are using something which is imagination. What is imagination? Imagination is the ability to use the same five sense perceptions without the body. If I want to imagine, I can imagine the car, I can imagine touching it. If there are some flowers lying there on the car, I can imagine the flower and smell them. If there's food lying on top of the roof of the car, I can imagine I'm tasting it. Where is that coming from? Here is sensory imagination, physical, which we are seeing with physical senses. We have mental imagination by knowing things, but we're not seeing it. Then we can see them imagination. So remember, the whole type of experiences we can ever consist of these three. And when we use these physical eyes, physical ear, physical tongue, physical mouth, physical body for the five senses, we call it the physical world and physical consciousness. But when we can do it without the body, through imagination, then we call it the astral self, not the physical self. People sometimes wonder, what is an astral body? Astral body is the body you create when you imagine you have a body, but this is not this body. Astral body is the one which you can imagine that it can walk right now, go out and check the car is there and come back through imagination. That's the astral body. People think astral body is somewhere hidden, somewhere in some high region. We have it right here. We are using it every day. Whenever we imagine something, we are using our astral body every day. Therefore, the astral self is working within this physical body and can be used to go out of the body whenever we like and come back into the body by imagination. Then the mental imagination lies in our mind. The mind creates the sense of perception. The astral self divides it into different 5 sense perceptions, and this body is using those sense perceptions and the mind inside to have experience of the world. Very simple. When you die, what happens? These 5 senses of the physical body disappear. They are in the body. But what about the imaginary self? Does that stay, or that is also part of this body? Is this brain functioning to create it, or does it still last? That's the experiment we have to see. The experiment is how we can, with a certain technique, become unaware of this body, identical to actual dying. Now, that is where we find out that the awareness that we have can be reduced by putting attention on one thing. If I put my attention on these flowers and keep on looking at the flower, I'll soon not know what is happening outside or inside here. I may have a blurry view of people sitting out there, my attention in the flower. If I concentrate my attention, which means put more of the attention on the flower, I will become unaware of other things. And supposing I keep on putting attention on it, only flowers will exist in my awareness, nothing else. The same thing we can do now to ourselves. Forget the flowers, forget the car outside. What about the one that is inside that dies last in the head? Let's try to put our attention on that. How do we put attention on something inside our head? Imagination, astral perceptions. With astral perception, you close your eyes, imagine you are there. Imagine a nice, beautiful chair. We are sitting on a chair outside. We can imagine a similar chair inside and sit and relax on it. Anybody can do that. But merely doing that is not enough. Do that and put your attention on that chair and your own self sitting on it, and concentrate your attention there and watch what happens. If you concentrate your attention behind the eyes, in the center of the head, which dies last, if you put your attention there, you will slowly find out you don't know where your feet have gone. Keep the attention there, you won't know where your hands have gone. Keep the attention and concentrate more, you won't know where the legs and arms have gone. Actual experience of your body, physical body. Keep attention there, you will see the bottom of the body going away. Identical process to actual dying. No difference at all between the two. Eventually, you will know only your imaginary self is there, you are unaware of the body. Just by one exercise, just by putting your attention on your imagined self in your head and concentrating attention on that, you can become completely unaware of your body. Then what happens? Your imaginary self is still there. What does it have? Does it have eyes? Yes, it has. It can see things. You can imagine anything and see it. Does it have ears? Yes, it can hear any sound, imagined, built up, or real. Does it have hands to move and feet to walk? Yes, it has. It's a copy of this body. Therefore, we can do anything with the inner body. Does it also have a mind like we have here? It does, same mind. Does it have an identity? We know we have an identity. We are separate from others and we can talk to each other. And we know we are one individual amongst many. Does that exist? It does exist. It's just an experiment. Is that being inside the same that is in the body or one different? Same being, not different. same self. Same self that uses the imagination, same self that sits there unaware of everything. That's the beautiful way that we have been constructed. Our consciousness has been built into a frame like this body. And when you can become unaware of the outer body, the inner body becomes alive with the same mind. One difference, the sense perceptions of the astral self are very sharp, much sharper than those on the physical body. In old age, like I am now, over 92, I have to read a paper, I need glasses. And even then I have to squint a little to see if I can read. Try to read the same paper when I close my eyes and imagine I'm reading the paper. I can read very nicely the finest print. I can hear the finest whisper in us. And here I may have to use some hearing aids. The inner sense perception, the same five, are so sharp, they're perfect compared to what we have here. So the experience inside of seeing the imaginary world is far stronger than the experience we can ever have with the physical body on. So that is why merely experimenting to see if we exist other than the body is successful. Not only we find out we do exist, even if the signs of death are simulated, artificially made up by pulling attention, that we are still existing and existing in a far more perfect state, far more perfect bodies. But that's not all. The most important thing that happens is, how do we remember things there like we remember things here? How do we use our memory? Here, if I want to remember, what did I have for breakfast? I put my thoughts, yeah, I remember. What breakfast did I have 3 years ago? Very hard to remember. Memory in the physical body is a very, very limited memory. We forget almost everything. Very few things, mostly traumatic or very highly exciting, those things we remember easily. Other things, daily routine, we forget all the time. Therefore, our memory is very poor here. What about the memory there? Experiment that now. Experiment number two. We have been able to withdraw attention and living in our imaginary state with all the sense perceptions and a body there. And then we try to imagine something of the memory of that body. Through what? Where is the memory stored? In the mind. This mind in the physical body, the brain, is carrying memories. So we remember things from here. What about the brain of the inner body? Does it have a brain? We don't know, but it has a head, all right. Okay, let's try to remember things there. Like we try to remember here. Memory is very sharp. We remember our childhood of that body. We remember what happened 100 years ago. We remember what 500 years ago. It's our memory. Nobody else is putting those suggestions into us. We can remember things that happened to us earlier than the birth of this physical body. That's a very important thing. It's a very important experience to have, that with the inner self, which we think we are creating imaginatively, when we try to remember things in that inner self, we can remember things that happened way before this physical body was born, confirming that what we thought was an imaginary body lived longer than this physical body. There is no better proof than our own memory of what happened. We remember the exact instances of what happened long ago. When we have that experience, it confirms the inner sensory body is not as imaginary as we thought. It's real. That why we have made it imaginary is because of our consistent emphasis on this physical being real. We can't get rid of it. The physicality here is so real that we start calling that inner sensory perception as imaginary because of this reality. If you are willing for experiment to say, I don't believe anything is real, let me test it out. Let's test, this is also unreal. I'm imagining this world also. Then look at imagination, you'll see the inner body is more real than the physical body. Takes a little time for that. Not because it's a very difficult exercise, that we have grounded ourselves into believing the current physical reality we are having is the only reality. This is so much ground into us. To ungrind it, to unlearn it, takes time. Otherwise, the exercise is very simple. When you remember things that happened earlier, it's amazing. So you know that you have an inner self. What is the advantage of knowing it? Because we are curious people. We are always curious about knowing something more. We are curious, is there life on the other planets? Are there life in the galaxies? Is there something strange happening somewhere in space? We are interested in that, and this body can't go and take us there. Inner body can. Why? It has no weight. It has everything except the weight of this body. It has everything except the molecules and atoms of physical matter. We are becoming unaware of the physical matter, opening up on that, and with that body, we can fly very easily. What is preventing us from this body from flying is a very strong pull of gravity holding us on the planet. We have such a hard time pushing ourselves away from here, even in artificial machines. There we can pull ourselves when we like. We can jump and go as high as we like. No gravity is pulling us. Therefore, flying with the inner body becomes very simple, and you can satisfy your curiosity about this world and another world also that exists which we can't see with these sensory perceptions which we can see with inner perception. That's beautiful. But that's not the end of the story about discovery yourself, because this particular exercise, these two exercises I told you, they are very interesting for people who are curious. One, to know about themselves. Two, to know about more creation. How vast is the creation? And they can examine it themselves. But for those who want to know, what is our mind? Where do thoughts come from? Where is memory stored? Is memory built up or is memory stored? Do we have to create activity to have memory, or can we just have memory without activity? These are very big questions. Very big philosophical questions. And answers to that are lying in step 3. Step 3 is, close your inner eyes. Like you close these eyes to imagine better, close your inner eyes of the imagined body and withdraw your attention at the center of the head of the inner body, no matter where it is. It can be done while it's walking. It can be done while it's sitting. Most people, because they sit here quietly and close their eyes, they are so used to it, they do the same thing inside. They think we are sitting on a chair or we are sitting on the floor inside and then closing our eyes inside and withdrawing attention there by concentrating attention on the self, in the inner body. Then what happens? That's the strangest part. Not many people have done it. I know it. We are too grounded here to go even the first step. And second step comes only after you are well acclimatized to the first step. So this step of withdrawing your attention in the inner imaginary self, a great exercise, real meditation. That's the best meditation I can think of. When you meditate like that, gradually even your sense perceptions disappear. Perception remains. Then you discover that perception is not done by your imaginary body at all. But they perceive everything without having to break it up. Then some confusion also starts for people who are beginners on this. They start seeing music floating in front of them. And they can hear a paper on which they are reading something. This gets reversed. They start fragrance coming from light. It is a confusing experience. But if you practice it for a while, you realize that all the sense perceptions are coming from a single source. And that source is nothing else than your own mind. We have never had that experience otherwise than by doing this kind of meditation. Very beautiful meditation to be able to withdraw to the level of your mind and forget this body, be unaware of this body, unaware of your sense perceptions, and knowing you can perceive everything directly without breaking it apart. Mind can do it. It is doing it. Even now it is doing it. But in order to make it understood, we break it into pieces. The sense of trying to make everything understood, to make sense. You make sense by a process called analysis. Break it up. Mind is always doing that. To understand what you are perceiving, you break it. I am seeing it, I am touching it, tasting it. But have the grand experience of perception without breaking it up. It's possible. See how thoughts are running automatically. See how thoughts are creating. What you are thinking is creation outside. Your own mind is creating everything. It takes a long time to sit there and understand what the mind is. Is it somebody else's mind that you're talking of? Same self that now thinks I have a body. The same self that says I am imagining it. The same self has the same mind. Self has not changed at all. You will never feel it somebody else. It's yourself having an experience. So the same self is now having an experience of having a mind that thinks. A mind at the higher levels when you go in that level, spend time there, that the mind is not recalling things, it's creating recalls. It's not remembering things, it's creating memories to remember. Very difficult to understand this. That when we say we remember something, we think it happened, therefore we remember. That's the only way we can remember things. But people, even here, have been given suggestions. A hypnotist can give a suggestion that this thing happened. When you come out of hypnosis, you say it happened. You're sure of it. You remember it. Visually, in all sense perceptions. That means you can implant a memory inside your head and think it actually happened in the past. What we are calling past lives today, and this life at its past, is all being manufactured at that level of the mental self through memories being installed there. It's a very important factor to know, because then you realize the very nature of creation. This creation is, I remember this happened, I saw it, I can still visualize it. It's all happening because of implanted memories. Who implanted them? There's nobody else there except the same self that we have here. Self has not changed at all. Same self has implanted memories and then come down to the level of the sense perception, level of a physical body and matter, and is experiencing it as life. Every step we are taking now is a recall of memory installed in us. Very often I give you the example of the nature of time. I repeat it again. We say we are living in the present. What has already happened is past, How do we know it as past? Because we can remember it. Supposing you can't remember it, there is no past. Examine these points I'm making. If we cannot remember something, it doesn't exist. How does it exist? We can remember it. It happened. Memory is the only reason to believe we have a past. It happened. We remember it. When are we remembering it? In the present. Now. Now. That's the word. Yeah. Somebody presented a book to me by Eckhart Tolle. Live in the Now. Now. I was very surprised. I was amused. I was laughing. I want to meet any person in the whole world who says he's not living in the now. I don't know any person like that. We are all always living in the now. What is this exhortation? Live in the now. We are living in the now. We cannot live anywhere else except in the now. And what is now? Now is what we call present. What is not now is either past or future. Only now is where we are living. What hasn't happened is future. What has happened is past. We are now in the now. The beauty of this now is it has no time at all. Not even a nanosecond. Not even a billionth part of a nanosecond. The moment we start thinking of anything is past. It's gone, time. Before we started thinking, it was future. So now is merely a meeting point of past and future. There is no, and we think we are living in the present. We are living in a timeless present. Completely timeless. But we are very sure we have time. We are constantly sure. We say 1 hour passed, 5 minutes passed, we look at our watches, we remember. Every evidence we want to use that a present and a past exist is memory. If I want to remember, did I said this word now, 1 second ago? It's memory. That happened, I remember. Therefore, we are living in the illusion of time created by recall of memory. Very interesting. Why do we call it present? Why are we calling it timeless now as a present in which things can be done? I can talk to you in the present. I can drink a sip of water in the present. Here I am going to do it right now to demonstrate to you. Tasted so good in the present. In a timeless now, I had it. How do I know I had it? I remember it. Consider this. There is no present except what you can remember, and that's the past. It may be instant past or maybe remote past. This was instant past, and sometimes it's remote past. When it's instant past, it means the past that took place only a few seconds ago, few minutes ago, maybe 5 minutes ago, is present. Present is nothing else but an immediate past. Maybe there is a future from where all this is coming in. Let's examine that. Is there really a future in terms of time? Let's examine. Supposing we lose the ability to hope. Supposing we stop hoping. Now we are hoping, all of us are hoping for something or the other. I hope this happens, I hope this happens. All the time we are hoping for something. Supposing we stop hoping and we are also afraid we might miss something, that bad thing may come, bad news may come, we are also afraid. Supposing we stop fearing and sometimes we anticipate when will this meeting end. Supposing we stop anticipating, which means supposing hope, fear and anticipation disappear from our life, there is no future at all. Examine carefully. These three things happening in the now are creating a future, and since now has no time, they are being created in the immediate past. Therefore, the future which we think of is all past, also being recovered through the memory of now. It's very interesting. That's how we are creating everything by memory. Where did memory come from? That's what the answer will come. Second level of meditation, go and examine your mind and how the memories are being created and installed. They're not already existing. You create. How many patterns of memory can we create? Now, we have a life which is different from everybody else. We have life forms here, insects and trees and birds and animals. They're all having life form. And how much can we create? There's an unlimited supply of memories we have been creating over millions of years. All in this head. The scientists say, oh, it's just in the DNA molecule. The DNA molecule is carrying the history of your entire billions of years. Ever since creation came into being, they say it's carried in your DNA. And DNA has caused evolution and brought you to where you are today. Otherwise, the DNA shows that we are very similar to people who lived a million years ago. We are very similar to dogs and cats, very similar to birds, we are very similar to insects, we are very similar to germs, bacteria. We look at the sequencing of the DNA and we see what is the relationship if we are 100 units of perfection. What about a chimpanzee? How close he is to us? 99.999%. The difference between a chimpanzee, an animal, a monkey, and ourselves is 0.0001%. The rest of the DNA is the same. We eat a banana, it's just a fruit, a tree. The banana tree has 50% same DNA the human beings have. Human beings carry the entire past. This is science. What about spirituality? What about mysticism? What about discovering for yourself? If you withdraw your attention there, you will find that you have been creating these memories for a long time, and the DNA molecule is nothing more than the physical representation of what the mind does in its purity at that level. You can check it out. All I am saying to you is worth checking it out and is practical. Now, if you are able to find that what life is merely a set of events picked up from the mental plane, which we now call the causal plane. And we call our mind causal body. Why? We are still wearing it. Life consciousness is still wearing something that operates in time and space, creates the effect of cause and effect in the events, and therefore we are wearing something, so we call it a mental body or mind or causal body. No difference. It's the same thing. And that is generating all the patterns which we are then playing out in the astral and physical body. When you see this whole drama, imagine, how would you feel? You will not be able to contain it. You realize something. All the answers come to you about the whole of creation and about yourself, who you are. Remarkable. We have all got the competence to do it. We have all got the stuff that will enable us to do this, what I'm talking of, inside our heads, all of us. But we have distracted ourselves, put our attention away from ourselves onto experiences at different levels. Right now, the experiences are being generated from inside the memory core being worked out. Looks like real life going on here. I sometimes compare those capsules of memory that are implanted in us, like DNA, not like, what do they call the recorded thing, what they pick up to play?
DVD.
DVD, not DNA. DVD. That's a physical thing. DVD, what is a DVD? What does DVD mean?
Digital video disc.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Very happy. Digital. Very good. What is digital? Oh, I know what digital is. Digital means zero and one. Is that right? Is that right, correct? When we say digital, it becomes zero and one. Does it really become zero and one? They say we are using digital technology in our appliances. Here's my phone. Everything is built into this, all that I can see, messages, memories, everything, through zero and one. But I had a better chance to look at the little thing inside there, called a chip. It's a chip that contains everything, not the rest of the phone. The little chip that is there contains everything. What does it contain? It contains zeros and ones, nothing else, implanted on silica base, silicon. Now, when I looked at it, how a zero and one implanted there? I was surprised. If an electric current can flow through that very pure silica, if it flows through that level, it's called one. If it cannot flow, it's called zero. There is no such thing as two digits. There is only one digit. One. Absence of one is called zero. One is called one. It's only one digit. Now, if I were to say all the songs I hear, all the messages I get are all one, coming from one, they are. The digital technology tells us that everything is coming from one. Is it the same situation inside? If we now look at what is happening at the mental state, we find it's all coming from one single consciousness, and it plays its role by doing so many things, just like this phone does, just like any other digital device does. So I sometimes say, we have prepared digital video recordings, which are just produced by storing memories, artificial memories, generated with our wonderful power of the mind to generate concepts. So when the concepts are put together, we say there's a beautiful story. We are holding a DVD in our hand, right? A DVD has a story. How long is it? They say this one is 3 hours. They write on it, am I holding 3 hours in 1 second in my hand? If I don't play it, I am holding the entire story of 3 hours play in almost zero time. When I play it, what happens? It becomes 3 hours. If I don't play it, put it back, it's zero time. What is the nature of time then? If we can encapsulate 3 hours of play, 3 hours of video play, which we see on a screen, into a little platform holding in our hand, which can be all held in zero time, and when played becomes time, don't you realize the same thing has happened to us here? That the DVD generated by us for play out in life was generated in no time. But when you want to play it, it becomes a life here and we play it. We are all playing our own DVDs. DVDs that create life. Exactly like the technology of a DVD, we are generating it from there. One has to go there to examine these statements I'm making. But if you go there, you'll find that there's such a huge choice of DVDs to play, which we have generated over time. Now, one most beautiful thing we generate there is the notion of time through memory, which means if we didn't have that mind, we won't even have time. Not even a memory, not even a time, not even zero, and no DVDs. Will there still be something left there? The self that is examining the DVD will still be there. The self that picks up a DVD, generates a DVD, picks up a DVD is still there. That means you can go beyond time, beyond the mind, and discover who was generating the DVD, the mind, and everything. That's the final step. To really discover who you are. When you discover beyond your mind who you are, it's a remarkable experience. You are consciousness per se with the potential to create anything. And whatever the consciousness becomes conscious of is called life. That's what we are playing here. These are all experienceable through meditation. So I am talking to the curious people who want to know who are we and how is this world created. You find the answer inside. Inside your own self. Don't have to go anywhere outside. Outside will confuse you more and more. Inside will clarify you it more and more. So the whole secret of creation lies inside in our own self. Have we then discovered the self? Well, if we are in a timeless state, no life, nothing except a timeless state of the ability to be aware of things that we can create, if that is all, and we're just a unit of consciousness, we'll be utterly bored, I think. How would we feel living for immortality, infinity, sitting, doing nothing, there's nothing to do, seeing nothing, there's nothing to see, just sitting there by ourselves doing nothing? Won't it be terrible? I think it is terrible. Therefore, we jump back into creating a DVD and come back here again. How often will we do? Every time we go there, we like to do it. That is why this creation has become virtually permanent. Because we can't get out of it. We have to jump back into it. That being, the self, has sometimes been called the soul, the immortal soul. Never is born, never dies. You know why? You need time to be born and die. It's not immortal in any other sense. When we say soul is immortal, it cannot be born, cannot die, because there's no time to do that. Time is generated by the soul, by putting on another cover upon itself called the human mind, which generates time and space and puts events on it, makes it a memory, encapsulates it, and then opens up to play. The DVD plays out in the astral plane first, and then within the astral plane, in a dreamlike sequence, comes again and again in physical plane. In the physical plane, we have time to sleep at night. This physical plane doesn't run continuously. We break it up by becoming unaware of this, going back into another form of life called the dream state. And sometimes we have dreams within dreams, and we wake up from one to the other in time. We sleep at night, and we are very happy in the morning we wake up. Why don't we keep awake? Because the experience we have generated through this process is so intense, we need a break at every level. Not only here, at every level we need a break from the intensity of the experience we are generating through consciousness. The experience is so beautiful. We get so attached to the experience everywhere. But right now, I am sharing this information with you in the physical plane. So where is our attention now? On the physical plane. On what? On people? on objects, on thoughts or ideas. That's all. These are distracting us from even discovering who we are. Not only that, we are not only distracted, we are attached to these things. We love them so much. We love our show so much. We've forgotten it's a show. We make it absolutely real. We wanted to make it real because we were coming from reality. How can we, from reality, we just want to see a shadow? No, we want to see reality. We are bored into reality. At that end, we have to be here in reality. Therefore, we have done every possible thing to make this experience real. Every possible thing to make a dream state real during the state of dreaming. How do we do it? When we dream at night, we are locked off from the awareness of the physical body. We don't know where the physical body is. Yet we have a body, a dream body that runs around everywhere, flies, does so many things, meets friends, has discussions, falls, is afraid, has emotional self. The dream body has everything. And where is it? We say, I am flying in the sky now. In a dream state, one can tell another person the dream. I am now gone to Mars. Who has gone to Mars? When you wake up, you went to Mars on the bed where you are sleeping. You went everywhere by going nowhere except in your own head. You never moved. The inner body moved, creating its own universe. Why were you afraid? Because you did not know it in the dream. You thought it was real. If you knew during a dream, it's a dream, you'll never be afraid. But we have most frightening dreams. We have nightmares, scary dreams. How can a dream be scary unless you take it as real while it's happening? And when you wake up into physical reality, thank God it was a dream. Can you imagine saying the same thing about the wakeful state when you wake up to the next step? It's awakening. When you awaken there, you laugh. How could I take those attachments so seriously? I thought they were real people I was attached to. Where are they now? Oh, some of them I know. They are in their houses sleeping also like me. But in the dream, we were meeting and hugging each other and doing so many things. They were not real. The real people were sleeping in their own places. How much emotional stuff I carried just by thinking they were real. Well, same state. Can we compare this physical experience as another form of dream? That the dreams we have when we go to sleep at night, let us say, are the basic dreams from which we can wake up and discover their dream. We can't discover while we are dreaming. By the way, some people say, we see a dream in which we tell us, this is a dream. I've also had those dreams. When you have a dream in which you speak the truth is, it is a dream. Then you tell all your friends, it's a dream, we are dreaming. And somebody says, where are we dreaming? And you can't answer. When do you find where you were dreaming? Only when you wake up, not before that. Therefore, you are speaking the truth without knowing it at all, without discovering it. That is how even enlightened people, they come and talk of higher wakefulness and they think we are awake. They're not awake. They're awake to the physical state. They're not, where are they? Otherwise, we don't know. They're sleeping in their own bed in the astral plane. Then maybe we can wake up one day and discover, thank God it was a dream. That bad accident I have, I thought was real. I thought it was bleeding all over. My body is intact. I'm fine. And maybe that's also a dream. And then we wake up again and discover that the mental self was the only reality. Then what happens? He say, all the perceptions we made, even DVD was unreal. What if we woke up again? And woke up and found we are the dreamer par excellence. We can dream within dream within dream and generate such experiences. We will be surprised. But at least we will not suffer. There will be no pain, no emotional pain, no physical pain, no suffering. Why am I emphasizing suffering? I can also say there will be no joy, there will be no happiness. I am not saying that. Because joy and happiness will still be there by this discovery. That's the wonderful part. That joy and happiness get separated from the law of opposites. Separated from the duality of this world. Here, duality makes the opposite appear. And we sometimes think that the two are created at the same time. Just like we thought of the digital chip, the zero and one are created at the same time. No, it's only one is created, the zero occurs because of one. Similarly, the duality here occurs because of the beauty, wonderful happiness we have. We just generate an opposite and make it a dual world. All these discoveries are possible within yourself. When we discover the beauty of wakefulness again and again, like when we are here, we remember, we dreamt, this is real, that is unreal. Higher up we'll say, that is real, this was unreal, that was unreal. Higher up, that alone is real. What I am saying is, at one time, we'll have only one reality. Maybe good enough. This is our reality. Thank God the bad dream I had last night is over. But if I wake to another reality, thank God that's the reality, but this was not too good, it's a duality. Maybe I'll go ultimately and wake up and say, thank God it was all a dream and I am in a great shape here. You will only experience one reality at a time. Is that our final destination on a spiritual journey? To discover who we are? That we are a soul, immortal soul, just come to enjoy created dreams within dreams within dreams? Is that enough? Not according to my master Baba Savan Singh. He says that is not the end of the journey at all. You have just discovered yourself, so what? You thought you were a body? You were happy. Then you found not the body is too temporary. You found another body that lasts thousands of years. So what? You found out that is also unreal. You woke up to the mind and found mind has a million of years of life. So what? Then you woke up and discovered you are a soul, immortal soul without time, space. So what? What have you discovered moving from one reality to another reality? Nothing. According to Baba Savan Singh. He says, you have to go one step more. And that is what one step? The discovery that the soul is not an individual unit at all. That soul is merely one unit in totality of consciousness which alone exists. There are millions of drops of water, very small sized. There are millions of drops of water in this glass, but there's only one glass of water. How can I make them million? Supposing I want to see million, I have to reduce my awareness to the size of a drop, that I'm aware of a drop. I expand my awareness and become the whole glass. I am a unit of consciousness experiencing all this. And when I enhance with that and expand my awareness, I'm totality. Our true destination is totality. What is totality of consciousness? Ultimate, from where the whole thing, including souls, are being created there. What is totality? Totality of consciousness means nothing that is there can be outside of it. If I pull even one soul out of it, it's no longer total. If I pull one experience out of it, it's no longer total. Totality means total. So a person, a human being sitting here, through meditation, is experimenting this to go within and goes even to discovery of the soul. And then some power expands that awareness from the individuated soul to totality. What will be the experience of the self which we are having? Total experience. Total experience means this physical experience will be also there. The next astral experience also there. The causal experience also there. The spiritual experience of a soul also there. The totality experience also there. You become totally conscious of totality. And therefore, a human being sitting here temporarily in a physical body has the means today to go within, and with the help of a perfect living master who is operating as another human being from the level of totality, therefore we are part of that human being in that higher consciousness. That higher consciousness can pull us to that level of the totality. What a wonderful opportunity. How great this body is in which this can be done. It can't be done in any other form, unfortunately. Trees can't do it. Birds can fly, sing, do anything, but they can't do introspection like this. Why is that? Because they're all living according to their DNA pattern, according to the program already made. We are also living like that, with the one difference. They don't think like us. Neither animals, nor birds, nor bacteria. They all think in a predetermined way. We are the only ones, human beings, only form which says, should I do this or not do it? Is it right or wrong? None of the other forms of life think like that. We are constantly trying to make decisions based on what is right and wrong. And how are we doing it? By a strange feeling that we can decide what to do. We have free will. And this free will is the phenomenon that distinguishes us from everything else. This free will, where is it coming from? Is it really free? Supposing I say, I want to decide whether I have the power to take a sip of water now or not. I can take it or I cannot take it. It's called quantum mechanics. Because then you're not sure which one is true. I am not sure if I'll take it. I'm not sure if I will. Who will determine? I will determine. Okay, I will. I took it. What did I use? Free will. And then I go to the astral plane and causal plane, and I find before I left that plane, this was written, I will argue like this, sitting in front of all of you, saying, should I take it or not take it? All the exact thing that I am now saying, all pre-written there already. It's amazing. Then how did I think? I was doing it here. How come I feel I have a free will here when really it was written beforehand? I go there and see everything was written beforehand, including how I thought, how I used my free will. Then how can I still feel free will here? It's all predetermined. The secret is very deep. Secret is, we picked up the DVD. We generated it. Therefore, it's our free will just being played again as free will here. At the top, we have real free will, where we can generate anything. That very free will is coming down even into the show we are in. And when we say, I can decide, we think the body and something sitting in the body is deciding. It was the self that was deciding. That is also in the body. Neither the body is deciding, nor the mind is deciding. The self is deciding. When did it decide? It decided in the now. Now has no time. Looks like it decided earlier because we have generated the memories and implanted them and we created a past. It was generated at the beginning of creation. Where was the beginning of creation? In the little capsule we are handling it in now. A very wonderful. Truth is so strange. Truth is much stranger than fiction. But the beauty is that we can still have all these experiences I've talked to you about. the last experiences, the soul getting merged into totality, has no role of the mind in it, and therefore no role of effort at all. No effort can give us this. Absolutely. I have tried very hard to find somebody who says, I can do something to cross the mind. No way. All meditation finishes there, every kind. Meditation is not the answer to go beyond the mind. Because meditation is a mental exercise, at best. What takes us beyond is what exists beyond. That joy, beauty I was talking of which we have created a duality here. That joy, beauty, knowledge, intuitive awareness of everything total. It's that awareness in which the most significant part, which we come and are thinking the most valuable, is called love. Love is the reality. Love is our reality. And our reality is playing all the way through. And we work on that reality of love through various means. We get attached to people because of love. We get attached to things. I love my car. I love my house. I got a new car. It's all mine. The ego plays upon love and makes it into a slightly different form called attachment. And we begin to call all these attachments as love. But when we are pulled from the mind by love of ourself, which we don't know at all about, then that part of ourself, which is total, which includes all human beings, works by creating a human being outside in a physical experience, and we call that human being a perfect living master. It's our own self appearing as a perfect living master. And when we experience his love coming from that state of totality, we are pulled to it. That's the only way that I know of being pulled above the mind, is through being pulled by love of something higher than the mind. And that is represented in our life right here by another human being whose love is like the love we want to get pulled, not an attachment. Then we are attached. We are two. I love you. When the true love, I disappears. We can't think of I. Beloved only exists. Therefore, those perfect living masters have such a strange, uncanny type of love, because totally non-judgmental, unconditional, permanent, infinite. Very difficult to describe. When I'm trying to understand with my head and my mind about the love I experienced with Baba Sawan Singh, my master, my mind frets and fumes and cannot explain it. It's something strange pull that we experience in spite of all the doubts the mind is creating. Fear mind is creating. Mind is creating obstacles to that, and the love still starts pulling us. That kind of love. These human beings are ordinary human beings like us. They know difference except one. Their awareness is total. That's all. And therefore, their love becomes the purest love which pulls us. When we want to go beyond the mind through an exercise that is inside us, it's having an experience called seeking. Seeking something, not searching. Seeking. Search, we search for things which we know what we are searching, and seeking is for the unknown. We don't even know what we are seeking. When that seeking is inside us and such a person appears in our life, then we discover what we were seeking. We were seeking the truth about our own self. Who are we? Who is seeking? The self is seeking, not the mind. What does the mind say? Don't seek. Enjoy what is happening here. Get more attracted to things here. And the seeker is ourself. When we seek, that human being appears. His love is such that when we say his love is pulling us so strongly, what does he say? Does he say, come to me, I love you, therefore be with me? He says, no. He says, go within yourself. And we tell such a master, we love you here outside. Why are you sending us away? He said, I'm not sending you away, I'm sending you to myself. I'm part of yourself inside. How can we check that out? Say, go in and see. When a perfect living master appears in our life and says, I am your friend and we are in love. He says, go within yourself, not outside. When we go within, same master sitting there, which you see in our inner self. Same master, same face, same personality, same conversation. Master is inside. And he says, go within. We say, no more. Now we found your inner self. Go more inside. We go to the mental causal state. Same master there. We say, now we find that you are the real one. No, go within yourself. And there he pulls us, because of his awareness of totality, to the state of knowing ourselves. He is merely a soul. I am also a soul. Then we are very happy. We are souls. No, he says, go within yourself. And soul is pulling itself. Actually, he then becomes the one puller. And we discover the master and the self were the same. They were no two. But we made them two for the spiritual journey that we are taking. So, I am sharing these things with you because I was very fortunate to be accepted as a friend, to be initiated by Hazur Maharaj Baba Sawan Singh, a perfect living master, according to terms I've just described. We'll have a break for some snacks, and I'll see you again at about 3:20. It's 2:20 now. 3:20, after 1 hour, I'll see you here. And if you have any questions, do we have...
We have a couple questions so far.
You have paper?
Yes.
If you have any question on what I have said or what I have not said, you can write it out and give it to Jonathan. Yes. He's here. And I will try to answer some of those questions at 3:20 when I come back. Thank you.